Hello everybody, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I'm Monica Sakrani. I'll now be taking you through the module Criminal Law 2, which is Rights on Arrest. Here we'll be looking at mainly the constitutional law provisions and Supreme Court judgments. This is a part of the legal literacy course. So we start with looking at what are the constitutional provisions on rights of arrest. We have already looked at constitution and fundamental rights. But what we haven't looked at is articles 20 to 22. We have looked at 21, but we haven't looked at 20 and 22 specifically. Now, articles 20 to 22 form the core of rights of accused or rights of arrested persons or rights on arrest, or what sometimes is known as prisoners' rights in the Constitution of India. So in this module, we'll be looking at constitutional provisions and judgments of the Supreme Court which have arisen in many PIL cases or public interest litigation cases, as you all already know. And in the next module, we'll be looking at the CRPC or the Code of Criminal Procedure and the rights that arise out of that. Now, what do the articles of our Constitution or what are our fundamental rights relating to rights on arrest? The most fundamental is no person shall be convicted of any offence. We are looking at the constitutional rights of persons in custody, and we'll be looking specifically at Article 20 to 22 of the Constitution. We've already looked at the fundamental rights and we know about public interest litigation, but we have not looked at Articles 20 and 22 in the when we did the Constitution, because we wanted to do them separately, because these form the Bill of Rights on Arrest. So these three form the core of what is known as prisoners' rights or rights of accused persons or right to fair trial in India. So in the next module, we'll be looking at rights under the CRPC. But now, right now, we will look at these three articles of the Constitution. So the first right of an accused person is that no person shall be convicted of any offence except in violation of a law in force at the time of commission of the act charged as an offence. In other words, criminal law to be prospective in application and not retrospective. Now, what does it mean? It means that if today speaking in a loud voice is not an offence, your decibel level does not matter, shouting and screaming is not an offence, but tomorrow if it becomes an offence, because I have shouted and screamed today, it does not mean that it will be an offence tomorrow. As we have already learnt in the last module, mistake of law or ignorance of law is not an offence, is not an excuse, and therefore I will be charged even if I say I did not know it was an offence. Suppose I say it was not an offence on this day, then why am I being charged? So therefore, a law, a criminal law, can only be what is known as prospective in effect. Means I know that this act is prohibited. I'm assumed to know that this act is prohibited. So I cannot be, so I will take due care and precaution not to do something. So I cannot be charged with something that is not an offense on the day I have done it. So that is the first principle of criminal law. Civil laws like income tax laws many times are retrospective in effect. That is, at the end of the year the tax slabs are announced and people then pay tax accordingly, or tax rates change and people pay tax for the previous financial year on the basis of that. So that in civil law, retrospective laws are permitted, but in criminal law, they are not permitted at all, and they are not only not permitted, they are prohibited by the Constitution. The second aspect of this retrospective application of laws is no person shall be subjected to a penalty greater than that which they would have been inflicted under the law at the time of the commission of the offense. So this is taking the argument a little further. Yes, the act was an offense on the day I did it, but it was punishable with a fine of 500 rupees. And tomorrow you make a law which punishes it with 5 years of imprisonment. Now, I may be ready to pay 500 rupees fine. I may not be ready to go for five years in jail. So I should not be punished with a penalty which was not in force on the day I committed the offense. So that is the second caveat of retrospective effect of laws. But what if suppose I, when I committed the offence, it was punishable with 5,000 rupees fine. Later on, the fine was reduced to 500 rupees. Do I get the benefit of that if my trial is held after the new law has come into force? Yes, I should get the benefit of a more beneficial, a more lenient law, but I should not be penalized by a harsher law. This is the sum and substance of the first part of our Article 20. The second principle of Article 20 is the principle or rule against double jeopardy. This is, no person shall be prosecuted and punished for the same offence more than once. This does not mean that an appeal cannot be filed, an appeal can be filed, but suppose I am acquitted by a court, a fresh charge sheet cannot be filed against me saying that now we've got this new evidence against you. You file an appeal, you say that we have got new evidence against this person, and it is for the court to decide whether it allows you to produce the new evidence or not. You cannot go all the way to the Supreme Court, I fight for 20 years, I get acquitted, then you say, nay, now we have some new evidence and we will bring new evidence. So this is kind of harassment is prohibited under law. So there is a rule against double jeopardy. This does not mean that, for example, if I have done something which is also a civil wrong, I cannot then say that, plead that rule of double jeopardy. For example, if I have committed theft, I'm working in a company, I've committed theft in the company, so I can be charged with a criminal offense. At the same time, disciplinary action can be taken against me, I can be removed from my job. A husband is beating up his wife, he can go to jail, she can also get divorce and maintenance from him. So that rule of double jeopardy does not extend to this, but it extends to criminal trial of the same offence. The third aspect of Article 20 is that no person accused of an offence shall be compelled to be a witness against himself. Now this flows from the right to silence that we saw in the last module. What does it actually mean? Does it mean that I cannot go to court, I cannot confess to a crime? I can, but I cannot be compelled to be so. Nobody can force me. I can voluntarily confess to a crime, but I cannot be forced to confess to a crime. Similarly, there are certain things that I can be compelled to do. For example, I can be compelled to give my fingerprints. I can be compelled to go through a medical examination. I am accused in a rape case. I cannot be compelled to be a witness against myself. So therefore, I will not subject myself to a medical examination. So there are certain things, my signature samples, my handwriting analysis. This has been dealt with in the Supreme Court in a constitutional bench judgment, which is referred to in your e-text. So please go through it. It is there. And the other thing that in which this whole question came up was the issue of narco analysis. Now the Supreme Court has held that no person can be forced to go through a narco analysis test against their will, and so that has to be voluntary. Witness against oneself has been held to be making a statement against oneself and not things like fingerprints, handwriting analysis, or medical examinations. Now, Article 21, we all know, no person shall be deprived of his life or liberty, personal liberty, except according to procedure established by law. So you've already done that in great depth. I will not go through it over here, explain it to you, but a lot of the law judgments which we will be looking at immediately after these slides of the Supreme Court have arisen out of the understanding of Article 21. And what Article 21 involves and what it does not involve, what is a procedure, what is a fair procedure, and that is something that we will be looking at later. So Article 21 is an important component of prisoners' rights or rights of arrested persons. Now we move on to Article 22. This again has the previous slide. This again has three aspects which are important to us. No person who is arrested shall be detained in custody without being informed as soon as possible of the grounds of such arrest. So when I'm arrested, I have to be told why I'm arrested, what are the charges against me, so that I know what are the next legal steps that I have to take and how do I defend myself against them. The second aspect is no person who is arrested shall be denied of the right to consult and be defended by a legal practitioner of his choice. So I have a right to appoint any lawyer I want to. The court cannot refuse to accept a lawyer unless there's a case against him and he's not allowed to practice. The second aspect of this is the right to legal aid. This is also part of Article 21, as we already know. But the aspect of it is that if suppose I am a person who's arrested and I'm in jail and I do not have the wherewithal to appoint a lawyer of my own, then the state is duty bound to appoint a lawyer for me. I have the right to legal aid. Though I don't have the right to say that I want Ram Jethmalani to appear for me, that is not my right, but a competent lawyer has to be appointed for me. And any trial which is conducted and a person is convicted on the basis of not having a lawyer would be held to be what is known as a vitiated trial, or a trial which will lead to an acquittal. The third right is that every person who is arrested and detained in custody shall be produced before the nearest magistrate within a period of 24 hours of such arrest, excluding the time which is necessary to travel. So apart from that, suppose I'm staying very far away, it takes a little longer to travel, but this does not mean that I should, suppose I'm arrested in Chandigarh and I have to be brought to Guwahati, it takes around 48 hours for me to be traveling. The general practice would be that I should be produced before a magistrate in Chandigarh within 24 hours, and that magistrate will then authorize further detention for the next 48 hours or 72 hours, and then I will be produced before the magistrate in Guwahati. So I should be produced before the nearest magistrate within 24 hours, and no person shall be detained in custody beyond such period without the authority of the magistrate. So this is a part of a fundamental right. Now we will be looking at some of the judgments. Most of the judgments that we are looking at come from public interest litigation. Now, one of the earliest judgments that came about is the Husainara Khatun case, which we will be looking at in the next module, where we will be looking at bail specifically. But suffice to say that the public interest litigation itself actually began as part of prisoners' rights jurisprudence, began with PIL, and PIL began with public prisoners' rights jurisprudence, because obviously one of the segments of society which is most marginalized, which is not able to access its rights, which is not able to come to court, are prisoners. As we all know, as social workers, we all know that most of the people in prison are poor people. Most of the people in prison are languishing in jail for several years. They are mostly under trials. Around 75% of India's population is under trial population. And so many of them obviously are not able to have the means to actually access their rights. They are in situations where their liberty is taken away. And so they are the ones who are most in need of their rights. And the Supreme Court in the earliest cases held that just because you are in detention does not mean Article 21 does not apply to you, because Article 21 means not just life, but life with human dignity. So that is, your human dignity cannot be taken away from you just because you are in prison. We'll be looking at the laws, at the judgments, but we will not be looking at them mainly in chronological order. We'll be looking at them on issue based, in thematic way. So the first judgment which is important for us is Jogender Kumar versus State of UP. This came in 1994. In this case, the court, Supreme Court, said that no arrest should be made just because it is lawful for a police officer to do so. Existence of the power to arrest is one thing, but the justification for its exercise is another. The police officer must be able to justify the arrest apart from his power. Arrest and detention in police lockup of a person can cause incalculable harm to the reputation and self-esteem of a person, and no arrest can be made in a routine manner on mere allegation of commission of an offence made against the person. It would be prudent for a police officer, in the interest of protection of constitutional rights of a citizen, and perhaps in his own interest, that no arrest should be made without reasonable satisfaction reached after some investigation as to the genuineness and bona fides of a complaint and reasonable belief both in as to the person's complicity and even so as to the need of to effect arrest. Now, in this particular case, it was a case of illegal arrest or illegal detention. And in this case, compensation was ordered to be paid to the person who was arrested on grounds that he should not have been arrested. Now, the next case that we will be looking at is the D.K. Basu case. D.K. Basu's case is one of the most important cases with regards to rights on arrest. It also touches upon the issue of custodial torture and custodial deaths, and it was meant to actually do something to prevent custodial torture and custodial deaths. So the Supreme Court issued several guidelines to prevent this from happening. So one of the most important direction which was issued was that every policeman who's arresting a person should have clear identification marks, should have accurate, visible and clear identification and name tags with their designations. And the person who has handled the interrogation of the arrestee must be recorded in a register. The second direction is that a police officer carrying out the arrest of an arrestee shall prepare a memo of arrest at the time of arrest, and this memo shall be attested by at least one witness who may be either a member of the family of the accused or a respectable person of a locality from where the arrest is made. This respectable person is known as panchas. It shall also be countersigned by the arrestee and shall contain the name and shall contain the time and date of arrest. A person who has been arrested and held in a police station or a lockup shall be entitled to have one friend or family member informed of his particulars about the fact that he has been arrested, where he has been detained. And if the person is already is a member, is it arrest is made in that person's presence and he's already signed the memo of arrest panchnama, then he need not be informed, any other person need not be informed. But if that person, the arrest memo is not witnessed by a member of my family or friend, then that I have the right to say that a member of my family, so-and-so, should be informed, or my friend should be informed. Suppose I've come from Bihar to Delhi to work, then I may not want my members of the family in Bihar to be informed, but the person, my friend in Delhi, to be informed about the arrest. So I will decide who has to be informed, and the police have to inform him. Now the next direction is, this time, place of arrest and venue of custody should be notified to, by the police where the next friend or relative lives. If the person lives outside the district, now suppose I want my family in Bihar to be informed, then through the legal aid organization of my district in Bihar, say for example, my district in Bihar is say Patna. So in Patna, the person, legal aid organization in Patna will be informed, and through them my family member will be informed. I should be told that you have this right to inform a family member. An entry has to be made in the diary at the place of detention where the person's, the who has been informed, my next friend or family member's name should be entered into this register, and all these, my memo of arrest, the register is showing who has been informed, has to be sent to the magistrate, and the magistrate has to see that yes, these requirements are complied with. I also have a right to be medically examined at the time of arrest, and whatever my injuries are, major or minor, should be recorded in my medical examination. This is known as the inspection memo, and it should be signed both by the arrestee and the police officer, and a copy to be provided to the arrestee and a copy to be sent to the magistrate also. And after that, every 48 hours, I have the right to be medically examined. I have to be medically examined, and I have the right to meet my lawyer at the time of my detention, at the time of my interrogation, though not throughout the interrogation, but I have the right to. My lawyer will also come and foresee that I will also check whether I've been tortured in any way or not. So these are all preventive steps to prevent torture. There has to be a centralized information system of all people who are arrested in the police control room in every district and in the state headquarters. And within 12 hours of any arrest, the information has to be sent to this state or district headquarters, where it has to be displayed on a conspicuous notice board. So, for example, if a family member is missing and I want to know whether the person is arrested or not, I can go to the district headquarters or the state headquarters to see whether the person has been arrested, and within 12 hours this information has to be on display. Failure to comply with any of these requirements will not only render the concerned officer liable for departmental action, but also for punishment for contempt of court. Contempt of court is non-compliance with the orders of the court. So you will be liable for contempt of court action, for departmental action, and also you can be liable for criminal action for torture or illegal detention. Apart from that, there is also, you will be directed to pay compensation to the victim who has suffered due to your non-compliance of the action. Yeah. Now we look at another very important case, which actually spoke about compensation for the first time. Now, as and said that it is not only the right, it is a part and parcel of Article 21 of the Constitution, as any kind of torture or illegal detention or custodial death is a violation of Article 21. And the person who has liable to pay the compensation is the state for any act of the agents of the state. So in Neelabati Behra's case was a case of a custodial death where the mother was awarded compensation by the Supreme Court as a right. Because her son died, it was held to be a violation, in a custodial death was held to be a violation of Article 21. And therefore, it was held that she has a right to compensation and the state has to compensate her. We now look at another case, very important case, Sheila Barse versus State of Maharashtra. Now, many of the directions in Sheila Barse's case are similar to that of D.K. Basu, including right to inform someone and right to medical examination. So, we will not be dealing with those, but it gave three important rights to women accused. One is that they said that women, when they are arrested, should not be, we all know that there are separate prisons for women and men, and even if there is no separate prison, in the same prison there are barracks where only women are kept and there are barracks where only men are kept. But unfortunately, in police lockups, this provision was not there. Women were kept in the same lockup as men. And now, one of the reasons for that would be that women actually account for around 4% of the total accused in the country. And so, probably a police station may get one woman prisoner, one woman accused in the year, or maybe two or three, maximum four. So, there is a high likelihood that you don't keep a separate room for women. So, because the fewer number of women accused are there, the court said that we can handle this problem by selecting certain lockups in, there should be certain lockups in a particular district which should be designated as a woman's lockup. Because at a particular time, maybe there will be just one woman in the lockup. At a particular time, there may be no women in the lockup. So, this lockup, which is selected as the women's lockup, should be in a decent locality, reasonably good locality in the city. And only female suspects should be kept over there, and they should be guarded by women constables. The other direction that it gave was interrogation of a female should be carried out in the presence of a female police officer or a female constable. The next important judgment with regards to women prisoners is R.D. Upadhyay versus State of AP. In this judgment, the main consideration was women prisoners and their children. So many women who are arrested are pregnant or they have young children who have nowhere to go. So till what age can these children be there with the woman in the prison, and whether they can be kept in the prison at all or not? So most prison manuals allow for children to be kept with their mothers if they are in jail up to a particular age, after which they are sent to a children's institution or family member if the family member is willing to take responsibility for the child. Now, the age differs in each prison manual because all the prison manuals are as per state, decided by the states. So, in this particular case, the Supreme Court said that 6 years of age should be fixed as the age till which the child can be kept with the mother in the jail. So this has now become uniform all through the country. After that, the child will be sent to whichever place the child can be kept with in where the child is safe. So if the child is shifted to an institution or child is shifted to a family member or somebody who is willing to take responsibility of the child will be shifted there and kept there till the mother is released on release from the jail, but the previous slide. But the mother has the right to meet the child even after the child is shifted out. The second important consideration is that when a child is born in the jail, his birth certificate or her birth certificate should not mention the jail in which the child is born, but only the district where the child is born. There should be a separate diet for children, medical facilities and special diet for pregnant women, lactating mothers and young children. And there should be nursery and creche for children of women prisoners outside the jail premises. So these are the rights that children of prisoners get. Now we proceed to look at some of the rights of prisoners in general. So these are two judgments in Sunil Batra's case. The references are there in your e-text. They came out in 1978 and 80. This Sunil Batra's case is a PIL. But Sunil Batra was an inmate in Tehar jail and he wrote letters to the Supreme Court which were converted into public interest litigations, into writ petitions, and directions were issued. Now basic direction was that no person shall be kept in solitary confinement in any jail. Solitary confinement means that I am kept in a place where I have no access to the outside world. I will not be allowed to get out of my cell. I cannot meet other prisoners. So they said this is violative of Article 21, but a person can be kept in separate confinement. That means I can be kept alone. Normally in jails, people are kept in barracks. So I don't sleep alone. I sleep along with other inmates. And I'm there, I interact with them. So even when I'm locked up at night, I still have human company. During the daytime, generally an inmate is allowed to go out and move around the certain areas of jail. At night, they are locked up and they are kept inside the barracks, but they share the barrack with other people. So separate confinement is permitted, that I may have a separate cell where I only sleep, but I should not be kept in solitary confinement. I can be allowed to go out, etc. Except in very few cases, separate confinement also has to be with the permission of the court. And if suppose somebody is found to be so dangerous that that person should not be kept, in a barrack with somebody else, he may influence others. Or I may want to be separate because I may be on death row and I may feel that no, I want to be alone, I want to pray, I need to be separate from others, and I make a request to do so, but that has to be done with the judicial consent. The second important direction that was given in this judgment was that district magistrates should inspect all jails regularly. They should hear representations from prisoners and there should be a grievance box kept in every prison, in every ward of every prison, which should be locked, and the key should be with the magistrate or the judge who comes to visit. And the magistrate should, every week when he comes for his periodic visit, every week or whenever, should open this box, and only he should see what is there in the box. And the grievances should be looked at seriously, and no person should be penalized for making a grievance, which is a genuine grievance. Yeah. The other three judgments we will be looking at are part of, as I told you all, that Article 21 has been interpreted to expand the scope of prisoners' rights. So there are three judgments. Khatri versus State of Bihar we've already looked at, that if a trial is held where a person does not have legal representation, then the trial itself will be vitiated or will have no value in law. So legal aid is a fundamental right under Article 21. The other two important judgments are Citizens for Democracy versus State of Assam. In this case, it was held that handcuffing is violative of Article 21 and no handcuffing should be permitted. Handcuffing can be only permitted even while taking a person to jail or from jail to the court and back. even then only with the permission of the magistrate, where you, the authorities have to justify why they want to handcuff the person. And the next judgment, which is very important, is Antule versus R.S. Nayak. In this case, it was held that fundamental right includes right to speedy trial. So every prisoner has a right to speedy trial. This has led to certain inclusions in the CRPC with regards to relaxation of bail conditions, but speedy trial is a right to fundamental right, though time limits have not been set and the delay should not be attributable to the accused. If it is delay which is not attributable to the accused, but systemic delays, like for example courts because of lack of courts or judge insufficiency of judges, or because of lack of escort, if there is a delay, then, or delay on the part of the prosecution in bringing the witnesses, etc., that would violate the accused's fundamental rights. So there's a recent judgment which has come in, which looks again, relooks at the conditions in jail. And in this case, which was passed in 2016, the court said that we have had around 30 years of litigation on prisoners' rights, and yet the condition of prisoners is still abysmal. And so in this case, the court said that there should be an under-trial review committee comprising of the district judge as the chairperson, district magistrate and district superintendent of police as members in every district, which meets quarterly and looks at cases of prisoners covered under section 436, that is those who are arrested under bailable offence, and 436A, those who have spent maximum of half the maximum term in jail without trial. So all these people have the right to be released on bail, and the committee to look at the implementation of also probation of offenders act, which is release of prisoners on probation, and lastly of compounding of offenses in compoundable offenses. So this committee should try and settle matters which can be settled. They should also appoint adequate number of legal aid lawyers so that cases can be tried and heard speedily. So in this module, now we've looked at Article 20, 21 and 22, and we've also looked at some of the key judgments of the Supreme Court on the issue of prisoners' rights. I suggest you all read the e-text which is available. D.K. Basu's case is a very good case that you all can read. A website which will give you access to all these judgments is indiankanoon.com. Also, Supreme Court and the High Courts have put up all their cases online. So if you go to judis.nic.in, J-U-D-I-S, you will be able to get access to all the judgments, almost all the judgments of the Supreme Court and also of the High Courts. So thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed it.